Hi, my name is Natalie, and this is Natalie Lawyer Chick. I'll be discussing popular topics through a legal lens. Make sure that you like, comment, and subscribe.
Hey YouTube, how's it going? My name is Natalie. I'm a criminal defense attorney, and you guys have been requesting that I cover the Michael Mcdonald case. I'm gonna put some little quick clips right here just so you understand why people would be asking for this. This case is crazy.
Put your hands behind your back.
I should actually call it the Michael Mcdonald cases because it's actually a case that originated in 2015 as a divorce case and turned into a criminal case over time. So there are several cases that came from this. There was a divorce case. There became some civil contempt, some criminal contempts, violations of protective orders, assault charges, and then forgery charges and wiretapping charges. This case covers the gamut. But I want to do a quick disclaimer here. Michael Mcdonald is a real person, as everyone is basically that I cover. I very rarely cover anyone that's fictional, but this is a current event situation. This case just concluded in 2020, and the people that are involved are real people with real lives who have actual consequences, who have access to the internet, and they can see all of these things. So I'm going to be talking about this case. It is going to be in two parts. I'm going to first talk about the initial divorce case, and then I'm going to talk about the criminal cases that resulted from this divorce case, right? Highly unusual for a case to go this way. And it's going to involve children and an ex-wife. And because of that, I am not going to be mentioning the names of the children that are involved in this case. There are two minor children. They're still children. I'm not going to be mentioning them. Michael Mcdonald is the husband in the case. Candace Mcdonald is the ex-wife. And they have two children together, and they got divorced. I've actually spoken with Candace Mcdonald and gotten her approval to cover this case with the promise that I not bring up her kids or their location or anything like that as far as their names are concerned. I'm gonna talk about them, but I'm not gonna be talking about like how old they are approximately, what their names are, where they go to school. A lot of that information was actually leaked in these copious online information that was provided to the public, and I am not going to participate in providing any more information about the children. So if you guys are learning about this for the first time, I know there's gonna be a desire to research, and look things up, but this is a warning not to do anything to contact Candace, contact the children, find out anything about the children. Let's just enjoy a story about what can really, really go wrong in these family law divorce cases. Divorce is some of the most contentious types of cases that exist in legal practice, and it often can result in very hurt feelings, loss of financial resources, emotional distress, and rarely, sometimes, criminal charges. So I wanted you guys to kind of understand that framework by which I'll be talking about this. Finally, as a trigger warning, this case will cover issues of domestic abuse. If domestic abuse is not something that you can sit down and listen to, and you don't want to hear anything about that because that might upset you or open something up inside of you, skip this video. I'll have more videos for you in the future that don't cover that issue. But I just wanted you guys to be aware of that. So jumping right into this, who are the people that are involved in this? As I said previously, Michael Mcdonald is the ex-husband in the situation. He worked in some type of information technology capacity with a GPS tracking company. And also Candace Mcdonald, who is a school teacher. She is no longer Candace Mcdonald. She has since remarried. She has a different name. Candace and Michael got married sometime around 2011 or 2012. They moved into and purchased a home together, and they had two little children. From the outside, they looked like a nice couple, right? He was working his job, she was working her job. They were living the American dream. They were attending church together. They were parents, what a lot of people basically hope to have. They were working towards debt independence. I think that they both spoke about working the Dave Ramsey program. A lot of couples work on that in order to get out of their debt as a couple. They were paying off each other's student loans and credit card debt and things of that nature. So again, they looked from the outside like a pretty decent couple. Michael had political aspirations, which I'll talk about later, that came sometime after the dissolution of the marriage. However, on the inside, as has been admitted by both Michael and Candace, although Michael had a very interesting way of talking about these things, he pretty much admitted to them in his testimony and the statements that he made to the court. Much of it is available here on YouTube. The relationship did become violent at times. So it does appear that aside from regular couple issues, Michael would restrain Candace. He at some points threatened her. He was known to be armed in the home or possess weapons in the home, and held her down to the bed, made her physically uncomfortable. He restrained her. He made her feel uncomfortable, yelled in her face. At one point, Candace did say that she would try to yell at him to get him off of her, that he did physically abuse her, that he never punched her, but that he physically abused her and intimidated her. Aside from the physical assault that took place in the marriage, Candace does also contend that Michael was controlling. He was controlling of the finances, that he did not want her to spend her own money. On Michael's side of things, he believed that Candace spent frivolously, and he disagreed with the things that she spent money on. Those were his justifications, but she thought that he was overly controlling in his behavior. They also disagreed on medical treatment for the children. They disagreed on a host of different things. And as a result of the physical abuse within the family, and again, I just talked about the restraining, but there were other allegations that were made about physical abuse. And again, Candace made it very clear it was short of hitting, but physical painful contact from Michael. Candace decided to file for divorce. And in 2015, they proceeded to a divorce basically hearing in front of the Honorable Judge Linda Marquis in Clark County Court in Nevada. Now, Mr. Mcdonald was represented by counsel, George Maglaris, and Candace was represented by Russell D. Collings. It seems like it's gonna be a pretty straightforward divorce. You know, they had two kids, they had a house that they needed to divide up. Of course, these things cause a lot of issues, but it's not the first time that anyone gets divorced. It's not the first time that you have to split custody and split property and decide assets. However, this divorce became extremely contentious over time. So several things became of note in this case as far as the procedure of the case was concerned. Starting out initially, Mr. McDonald's initial attorney, Mr. Maglaris, took his own life while the case was pending. And that was sometime before the evidentiary hearing was supposed to proceed on the divorce. So Mr. Mcdonald had to find a new attorney. And the judge, Judge Marquis, gave him time to find a new attorney, and he, in fact, did so. Other things that happened during the divorce proceeding, which were pretty notable, is that right before they went into the evidentiary hearing, Mr. Mcdonald actually called Judge Marquis's husband, who is also an attorney in their area in Nevada, to see if he would represent him since he had lost his attorney. The interesting thing about that is that Mr. Mcdonald had already had new counsel, and Judge Marquis and her husband had the same exact name. It was completely irregular for Mr. Mcdonald to try and contact Judge Marquis's husband to represent him when she's the judge that's presiding over the case. So it seemed as though Mr. Mcdonald was trying to manipulate the situation by trying to force Judge Marquis to recuse herself by contacting her husband to represent him. So he thought by getting a consultation and getting the husband to represent him, potentially he could get Judge Marquis removed from the case. That's how I interpreted it. And that's how I think even Judge Marquis and the other attorneys involved in the case interpreted it. It just didn't make any sense for him to have done that. Leading up to the divorce proceedings, visitation was done by way of exchange between the parents. However, her parents and his parents, or you used to have to get involved with them doing the exchanges because Michael would act very bizarre during the exchanges. Eventually, Candace got a new boyfriend, Joe Ruiz, and one of their children had a medical issue that Michael thought was being caused by the new boyfriend, Joe Ruiz, or was accusing Joe Ruiz of having caused the injury to the child. He accused Mr. Ruiz of being an abuser based on him searching up someone of the same name and that person having a criminal history for being an abuser, okay? And it turns out that this person was not Candace's boyfriend, Joe Ruiz, that he had, Joe Ruiz had nothing to do with the injury that was caused to the child. There was a medical explanation for the injury, but Michael persisted after it was very clear from the medical professionals that there was a medical reason for this issue that the child was having. He persisted in blaming Joe Ruiz for causing this medical issue and persisted in calling Joe Ruiz an abuser of children. And so there was a lot of animosity between Michael Mcdonald and Joe Ruiz and Candace Mcdonald, because ultimately what it looked like is that Mr. Mcdonald did not want to proceed with the divorce. There were times where, you know, the judge was would be talking to him in like status hearings and things like that before they got to the evidentiary hearing. And he would say things like, well, I don't think she really wants to do this. You know, I don't think she really wants to do this. So he was clearly in denial about Candace wanting to proceed and was trying to control the situation by accusing her boyfriend of committing heinous offenses, by saying that, you know, she was an unfit mother, she was an unfit parent. He was making those type of allegations against her. Before the evidentiary hearing as well, there was a protective order that was put in place against Michael because at one of these exchanges for the children, Michael attempted to get into a physical altercation with Candace and Joe Ruiz. He allegedly pushed Candace during this physical confrontation in front of the children when they were trying to do an exchange of the children. So it was very contentious leading up to the evidentiary hearing. And it appeared that Michael was disregarding the court's order that he stay away from her. So he was charged with assault, the crime of assault, for physically assaulting Candace and pushing her in the presence of the children during one of the exchanges. As a result of that, he was placed on supervised visitation with the children, and they were doing supervised visitation through a third party. Michael was unable to follow the orders that he have no contact with Candace, because he went so far as to do things like place a GPS tracking device on Candace's vehicle. Which this is very bizarre. You know, I've seen a lot of divorce cases. I've seen child custody cases. This is very bizarre, out of the ordinary behavior. That is not a statement of facts that you normally come across when dealing with something that has its impetus out of a divorce case. So he put a GPS tracking device on her car. Basically, they had at some point had two cars within the family. He took one car, she took one car. He still had the keys to her car and was refusing to turn those keys over and put a tracking device in her car. Well, he worked with a company that provided GPS tracking devices, and they wanted them to put them in their own cars, but he had never spoken with Candace about putting one in her car. Candace also believed that he was getting into her car. This is after they had separated, after there was a no contact order, after there was supervised visitations, because of the, you know, assaultive behavior that he had displayed against Candace. After all of that, that her seat would be found with the, you know, pushed all the way back, things rearranged in her car. When she was coming back from work, she would get into her car and her car would be all different over, you know, and this would happen multiple times. And she wasn't sure if it was him. The way that she figured out about the GPS tracking device is that their son and daughter came back from a visit with Michael, and the son said, oh, I want to look at you on the blue dot like how daddy does. Daddy showed me that he follows you on the blue dot on his phone. So he was, you know, the blue dot, like on a map, you would have like, you know, your location moving across on the map. He was following where Candace was going on, you know, his phone, and showed it to the son and told the son, don't tell mommy, because if you do, she'll tell the judge and daddy will go to jail. And Candace found this to be very concerning because she had never told her children anything about a judge or court or going to jail or anything like that. Like, she never involved the children, because they were so young, in what was going on between mommy and daddy, other than mommy and daddy aren't together anymore and we have to visit back and forth, but nothing to do with court. Michael was instead having very inappropriate conversations with the children, telling them, you know, mommy is bad. I'm watching mommy on the GPS. Mommy wants to put daddy in jail. Mommy wants to take you away. And the way that we know this is because at some point Michael becomes incarcerated for the first time in relation to the alleged or convicted assault that he committed against Candace and Joe Ruiz when he was trying to fight with them when he was supposed to be dropping off his children. So he went to jail, and while he was in jail and there was a no contact order that was in place between Michael and Candace, he sent her letters. And now remember, these are small children that cannot read. So, but he said he was sending the letters to the children, basically. And in the midst of that, in those letters he was sending to the children, he was really talking about, you know, mommy broke up our family, you know, mommy left me, mommy doesn't want us to be together, mommy put me in jail, it's mommy's fault, blaming her, knowing that this isn't going to be the children that are going to read this. It definitely wasn't appropriate for them to see, but it would be more likely Candace that would read it. And I guess he was trying to make her feel bad or something like that. So those are the type of things that were going on leading up to the evidentiary hearing and sometime after the evidentiary hearing and the divorce. Those are the things that happened throughout the life of the family law case. When you come to the actual evidentiary hearing, Mr. Mcdonald is represented by counsel at the evidentiary hearing. Mr. McDonald's counsel actually did a very good job as far as when they were talking about, you know, the establishment of domestic violence, because under Nevada law, if the petitioner for divorce can establish that domestic violence took place during the marriage, they can get certain findings in their favor. One of them being basically more physical custody of the children, because they have found in Nevada, you know, through their research and things like that, that abuse against the mother can precipitate abuse against the child, or abuse against the father can precipitate abuse against the child. So it gives the father or the abusing party less parenting time if they were committing domestic violence within the relationship. So the attorney basically pushed Candace on whether or not this was actual domestic violence, if she had not hit Michael herself. And she made it very clear that the only time she'd ever put her hands on Michael was in self-defense, was to get him off of her. The only time she yelled was to get him away from her. And that basically, you know, the whole reason that she'd filed this divorce case was because of the abuse that she had suffered at his hands. I thought that she comported herself very well, answered the questions very well as far as that was concerned. But he did do a good job of trying to point out inconsistencies. It's just that it was pretty clear that she was spot on with the abuse. He also pointed out things like Michael's attorney, she did not call the police, she did not seek help, those types of things. But she made it very clear that she felt intimidated to do so. He was armed in the home, she was afraid of him, and that's why she filed for divorce, was to get away from him before going and seeking help, and now she's seeking help. It was very clear throughout the divorce proceedings that Michael was a very difficult client to deal with. He was constantly, and again, I said he had a good attorney, but he was consistently whispering in his attorney's ear, interrupting his attorney, trying to speak up out of turn, those types of things. And it was clear that he was a very difficult client, but the attorney was very good at managing Mr. Mcdonald. Candace, on the other hand, seemed to have a much more symbiotic relationship with her attorney. They seemed to be, you know, in step, and they were working very well together. So, you know, his behavior between becoming incarcerated and getting protective orders and violating those protective orders, you know, were all very concerning. And you could see the type of behavior where he had a hard time controlling himself throughout the hearing. You know, you could hear the constant whispering, you could see the constant attempts to interrupt. He had to constantly be reminded by the court not to interrupt the court, not to interrupt this, not to interrupt that, even though he had a very competent attorney at his hands. Oh, and just so we're clear, as to the tracking device, Michael basically admitted to putting the tracking device on Candace's vehicle. He admitted to doing it, right? Like, he said that he did it. So there was no question that he had put a tracking device on Candace's car. But he said that he did it not to track her, but because it was always there. But her father, her stepfather, came in and testified that he had done work on her car before and it wasn't there before. And she said that it wasn't there before. And her mechanic said that that wasn't there before because they would have, that's the port that they would have plugged into in order to run diagnostics on the car. So there's no way that it was there previously. And it looks like it had just been recently added by Michael. Also admitted that he handcuffed Candace. He tried to play it off as something that wasn't that serious, but Candace definitely made it very clear that this was something that was against her will. And basically, after hearing all the evidence and the fact that Mr. Mcdonald had the inability to follow the court's orders, the inability to, such as stay away from Candace, don't contact Candace, you know, don't talk to the kids about inappropriate things, only contact them on this parenting app they use called Talking Parents, only talk on this. He just had a really, really difficult time. I think that's a nice way of putting it. Comporting himself with the court's orders. He just did not listen to instructions. And in addition, she did find a sustained domestic abuse against Candace. She ordered that Candace and Michael were to share joint legal custody, but that Candace was to have primary physical custody. That meant that Michael would have visitation of the children, but he would not have full access to the children. He wouldn't have them for long periods of time. He would just simply have them for visitation purposes. After the finding and decree of divorce, it was ordered first that Michael was to stay in the house and get it refinanced and then pay a portion of the half of the value of the home to Candace based on the refinancing of the house, because he wanted to keep the house. Michael used that as another means of gaining control over Candace. So basically what Michael would do was he was first ordered, because he didn't want to sell the house. And the court said, okay, Judge Marquis said, okay, you don't have to sell the house. What you have to do is keep the house and then refinance the house and then pay Candace the portion that she is owed from the refinancing of the house. Michael refused to get the home assessed and valued and refinanced. Like, he refused to go through the refinancing process. And it was the case was continued over and over again after the decree of divorce to give Michael the opportunity to refinance the house, and he would refuse. So he would show up with a new attorney each time, or show up by himself and ask for a continuance to get a new attorney. Eventually, the court ran out of patience with him and ordered for him to just sell the house.
Whether or not they're going to refi or not.
But Your Honor, we found the final orders for the Supreme
Court. All right. Mr. McDonald, I am not going to listen to one more excuse. I just told you what to do.
Yes, Your Honor.
You've got your order to sell the house. Mr. McDonald.
Your Honor, I will get whatever documentation that you need and cooperate, which I've been trying my best
to do. We've been trying to get you to do this for months, Mr. McDonald.
And I keep getting these.
You got a deadline.
Your Honor, I will be able to sell the
house. If you get it refinanced before they sell it, fine. Otherwise, the house, they have authority to list the house for sale. And if you won't sign the proper documentation, I will grant the order giving the clerk the right to sign the documents on your behalf.
Can my motion for stay please be granted?
Sell the house because Candace is owed half the value of the house. They both put in equally to it. They're both owed half the value of the house. So she was like, if you're not going to refinance it, I'm ordering you to sell it. Well, Michael gets convicted of the previous assault that he had committed and is put in jail. And while he is in jail serving his sentence for the assault, he communicates with his mother via the jail phone, which is recorded. And I've told people over and over again, those are recorded. He communicated with his mother that he wanted his brother to get a lease, to pretend like they had a lease for the brother to stay in the house and pretend like he was paying rent so that Candace could not enter the house, which she lawfully now had the right to enter it in order to sell it because the brother would be inside the property, or they would lie and pretend as though the brother was renting the property while Michael was in jail. And they said how they were gonna forge Michael's signature because he was in jail, you know, and basically submit this thing and pretend as though someone else was living there. The Mr. Collins, Miss McDonald, or Candace's attorney, did an excellent job of getting those recordings, and basically, once Michael, you know, was in court again, confronting him and informing the court that this is what Michael was trying to do. So basically, Candace was given the right to seize the property without Michael's consent and basically assess and sell the house, which is what she did. And so she got the value for the assessment of the house, but also she got her attorney's fees paid because Michael had undertaken those type of underhanded, you know, maneuvers to try and defeat the court's order. Basically, he was in contempt. So his punishment was that he would have to pay Candace's attorney's fees, like all of them, with the proceeds of the sale of the house. So he basically got no money out of the sale of the house because he tried to keep the house from being sold or refinanced so that Candace could get her fair share, basically. Another thing that happened like during the divorce hearing itself, which was pretty like interesting, was that it appeared to me that he was trying to lie and say during the divorce that Candace had stolen $10,000 out of their safe. They had a safe, and she said that no, there was only $3,000 in the safe, and she did take what was in the safe, but you know, she took it to like pay bills and things like that, but it wasn't $10,000. And he came in with like a ledger on the day of court that looked like he had like just made it up, and submitted that to the court and said, oh, Candace and I both signed off on this ledger. And Candace said that she didn't think that it was real, that she thought he had just made it up basically, but the court accepted it. That's interesting because that would be a preview of things to come in the case in the future. So now where we are in the case is that Michael is in jail. Michael only has visitation with the kids. Michael has had to have the house sold, so he doesn't have full-time custody. He doesn't have the house anymore, and he's in jail all because of his behavior during this divorce. It really didn't have to be like that. Like it was no reason for it to have been that bad. You know, if he hadn't have committed domestic violence, he would have had full, you know, joint legal and joint physical custody of his children. If he had not have assaulted Candace while the divorce case was pending, he would not have been in jail. And if he had just complied with refinancing the house, he would still have the house, and then Candace would have half the value of the house, basically. So as time went on, I think child support was ordered to be paid in the amount of $800 and something per month. Michael basically refused to pay the child support, paid sporadically or barely ever paid. Like, he never paid the full amount of the child support. So when Michael gets out of jail, he files to get more visitation with the children, to get more time in custody of the children now that he's out of jail, because there's been a change in circumstances. Basically, Candace had requested that he pay the child support. Michael requests more time with the children once he finishes serving his jail sentence and to resume contact with his kids. It had been a good amount of time since he'd seen his kids. And that was because he was incarcerated. So Candace also wanted Michael to start paying child support now that he was out of jail. So they went to court in order to hear the issue of paying child support and custody and visitation of the children. These hearings got continued multiple times because Michael had a really, really hard time with appearing in court with an attorney and keeping an attorney, because it was very clear that he kept having contentious relationships with his attorneys. They would appear for one date and then strike their appearances for the next. There's a myriad of reasons that a client might do that. Number one would be that the client is not paying. So, you know, the green case, as some attorneys call it, like money, like green, the green case. So he's not paying, so they don't want to represent him because he won't pay. Another reason that attorneys may drop out of the case is just a really massive disagreement with the client. Like, they just cannot get along with them. They can't work together. There's no trust in the attorney-client relationship. Maybe the client wants to go away that you find to be unethical. That's another reason that an attorney may withdraw from the case. So usually it's not like, oh, scheduling or something like that. That's not really a reason, but it's usually money or like a severe ethics issue. And for me, it seemed like there were a lot of ethics issues with the attorneys. He wanted to present certain evidence and the attorneys didn't want to do it.
Touches on that fundamental disagreement. He wants to take this in a direction that I'm just not willing to go. He wants to argue about his rights, his constitutional rights, and his understanding of his constitutional rights. His understanding of his constitutional rights, what he wishes his rights to be, rather than what they are. And I just can't. I can't take it in that direction.
Judge, I'd like to rebut.
Including, in addition to what you've already said.
Like how he came into court with that ledger saying that, oh, look, there's a ledger that we wrote up showing all the money that we put in and out of the safe. And it shows that there was $10,000 in the safe. And Candace said, no, there isn't. So like those type of documents that you're trying to present to the court, if they're not real, that's perjury, you know, and fraud that you're committing on the court. And so a lot of attorneys just didn't want to stick with Michael. So he had a lot of hard time. That's just how I read his inability to keep an attorney, but it could have been for other reasons as well. Now that Michael was out of jail, he did have this funny like way of continuously referring back to what happened with his attorney that ended his own life. And he, you know, kept referring to it during doing hand gestures, imitating what happened. And he tried to continuously use this as a reason for why things did not go well in his case, even though he was represented by counsel, a very good attorney, by the way, at the evidentiary hearing for the divorce and for many other hearings after that. But he kept trying to use that as a scapegoat for why things were not going well in his case. And really the reason that things weren't going well in Michael's case is because Michael was being dishonest, you know, and Michael was doing things that violated the court's order, and the court was finding it out. During these evidentiary hearings about the visitation and the amount of child support to be paid, Michael would do things like tell Judge Marquis that she should be recused from the case because she had been pregnant during some of their proceedings and just given birth. And he was saying, oh, you had a difficult pregnancy. I don't know how he would have known that. And there was no indication that was the case. And because you had a difficult pregnancy, you cannot be fair to me. He also alleged that Judge Marquis was biased against him because she had presided over his parents' divorce and that he had testified at his parents' divorce. Now, Judge Marquis said she had no recollection of that. And again, I don't know if the divorce happened when he was younger or many years ago, because his mother was remarried. He had a stepfather, but I don't know when that divorce happened or if it was even really in front of Judge Marquis. Judge Marquis contended she didn't remember anything about it, but he kept trying to find ways to get Judge Marquis off of the case because he didn't agree with her. But the funny thing is, when he had a different judge, when like Judge Marquis was out on maternity leave and it was Judge Hardcastle, Judge Hardcastle was a lot, her name really did suit her. Judge Hardcastle was a lot more difficult on Michael than Judge Marquis was.
Sweet. Your Honor, I have also in my counter motion, I'm asking for a motion to stay the orders pending the Supreme Court rulings because of the amount of payout was
denied.
It was not brought up in court, Your Honor.
Denied.
She took $10,000 from the safe. There's $2,000.
Denied.
Because Judge Marquis, I think, was trying to work with him. She was like, please, no contact with your ex-wife. Please stop contacting her. Because there was a no contact order in place because there was a protective order from the courts, the criminal courts, and the criminal case. There was also a civil protective order. And as a condition of the divorce, the active divorce case, even though divorce had been decreed, there were still issues that were in the jurisdiction of the family courts. There was a family court stay away order as well. Michael kept violating those stay away orders over and over again. So here's some examples of how he would violate the stay away order. He would violate the stay away order when there was supervised visitations put in place. Like I said, Judge Marquis was being, like, even though he didn't like her, Judge Marquis was being very, very nice to Michael because she didn't impose supervised visitation. But because of the type of communications he was having with the children, saying inappropriate things to them, arguing with Candace in front of them, all those type of things. When Judge Hardcastle took over the case while Judge Marquis was on maternity leave, Judge Hardcastle ordered supervised visitation, which means that they had to go to a certain center in order to do the exchange of the children. Michael would stay at the center to visit with the children, and then Candace would come and pick the children up. During that, there was one incident where he was late to come drop off the children. He was often late with the pickups and the drop-offs or whatever the case may be. And he was so late one time that they basically just had to leave because they had been waiting for him for so long. He shows up like a half an hour to an hour late, something like that. And when they're leaving, he starts yelling and screaming at Candace through his car, and he's not supposed to be talking to her at all. And so she documents that, as well as the center, also the people at the center see that. They also document that. They file a motion with the court, basically alerting the court that Michael has violated the no contact order. In addition, he also sent Valentine's Day presents through the kids to Candace. So he was saying that, oh, he was just helping the kids to pick out Valentine's Day presents for Candace. But instead, what it was like a bottle of perfume called Crazy Love with like a skull and crossbones on it. Now, it's not like he put the skull and crossbones on it, but he selected a perfume called Crazy Love with, or a, either the card said Crazy Love, but either way, the perfume had a skull and crossbones on it. And she found that based on their prior history of him, like handcuffing her and abusing her and pushing her and shoving her and restraining her and keeping her from leaving the house, she found that to be threatening and following her, you know, in the GPS tracking device and stuff like that. She was very, very upset by that, right? So she let the courts know that he was like sending her Valentine's Day gifts and things. And so basically the courts, especially Judge Hardcastle, was like, you are violating the terms of the supervised visitation. The supervised visitation like center, the place that's in charge of that, kicked them out. It was like, we cannot supervise visits anymore here because he's starting fights with Candace in front of the kids, you know, yelling and screaming at her, sending her gifts. He comes late. The coming late thing, like to drop off the kids was, or pick them up, was super consistent. Like even before the supervised visits were put in place, even Judge Marquis, who was pretty lenient, was very annoyed by that because she thought that that was, you know, disregarding the court's order. I say for you to do exchanges at this time and you're coming like a half an hour late or asking to keep the kids an additional day, and that's against my order. So everyone was tired of him doing that, and it was like, you know, it was a control thing, right? So they got kicked out of the center, when Michael basically did. And so all of his visitation got taken away because he couldn't comply with the supervised visitation. He couldn't comply with unsupervised visitation because he got into physical altercations with Candace and her then boyfriend, Mr. Ruiz. And then she turned around when he was on supervised visitation, was sending her gifts, was doing all these other like crazy things that, you know, were disturbing to the court and very, very concerning to the court over the pattern of behavior. When Judge Marquis was back on the case, she made it very clear, you know, I am concerned with your behavior. So before Judge Marquis comes back, Judge Hardcastle, like I said, took away all of Mr. McDonald's visitation. But, and you know, that can seem kind of harsh to some people to lose all of your visitation with your child. But she found, look, I'm going to take away all of your visitation. You get no visitation, but I'm going to give you a pathway back to visitation. I think something is going on here. Just to give a little bit more context, during the actual divorce decree hearing, Candace McDonald said, I think that Michael is bipolar because Michael told me he was bipolar. And after we got married, he said, you know, don't worry about it. I was diagnosed as bipolar, but I'm fine. I manage it. And then after they got married, he said, yeah, I was prescribed medication, but I don't take the medication. She says that's what Michael said. There has been nothing from a medical professional independently to verify that. Like there's nothing to verify that, but that's just what she said that he said. And it was allowed because it was a party opponent statement, right? So that's like kind of the background. And he's got all this erratic behavior. Okay. And then on top of that, when he was released from jail from the assault charges on Candace, a condition of his probation was that he was supposed to get a mental health evaluation by a mental health professional and take parenting classes. And say he was supposed to take like 15 or 20 parenting classes. Let's just say, for example, he took like 4 of the parenting classes while he was in jail. And then after he got out of jail, never took another parenting class again. Like he just completely abandoned it. So when Judge Hardcastle took away visitation, she said, look, go and get the mental health evaluation by a doctor, by a licensed mental health professional. I want a psychologist or psychiatrist. Get a mental health evaluation and finish your parenting classes. And once you do that, we'll work you back up to supervised visits and from supervised visits, unsupervised visits. So they gave him a pathway back to seeing his children, okay? Well, Judge Marquis comes back from maternity leave and they go back in front of Judge Marquis over and over again. It keeps getting continued because Michael keeps getting new attorneys. And again, this is the mark of a vexatious and difficult litigant, someone who cannot keep an attorney. You know, you get a second attorney, maybe even a third, not so bad. Michael must have had at least 6 or 7 attorneys on this case. I mean, that's just crazy. I've never seen anything like it before, right? So he's got all these attorneys that come back and forth. The cases keep getting continued. They finally go to an evidentiary hearing on custody and child support. And so again, divorce has already been granted. These parties are already divorced. And Candace is at this point engaged and remarried to Joe Ruiz. And you can tell that this really makes Michael angry. He is very, very angry about it. At some point, he starts making all these YouTube videos about her. He starts talking negatively about Joe Ruiz. He records his kids saying bad things about the mom and post it on YouTube, like telling his son to say, oh, isn't mommy mean? Don't you don't like mommy? I hate mommy. Mommy is mean. You know, like having the kids say negative things about mom because mom has gotten married and moved on, you know, with her life. So those type of, you know, overarching things are very like concerning. And then while all of this is going on, he's also, but we don't find out about this until later, recording Candace while all of the divorce stuff is going on, like without her consent, and then posting that stuff on social media, like the phone calls that they would have and stuff before there was no contact at all put in place. He was recording their phone calls and then posting it on social media, as well as, you know, coaching the kids to say bad things about mom. So that is the context at which we're at this hearing now for custody. Because, you know, Michael has been divested of all custody and he's asking for more time. And on the issue of custody, when there's already a custody order in place, the courts consider 2 things. Number 1, they consider what is the best interest of the child, which is the most important. What is the best interest of the children? And number two, if you're trying to modify a pre-existing custody order, has there been a change in circumstances? Well, there has been a change in circumstances. Michael was in jail for assault. He's now out of jail. He's now able to visit with his children. You know, he's taken four parenting classes. You know, let's see what happens. So they go to this hearing, and basically, at the hearing, Judge Marquis makes it very clear that she is very concerned. And of course, Michael has an attorney at first, and they do this like evidentiary hearing. But then on like the second or third day, his attorney like withdraws from the case and Michael continues pro se, like representing himself. And Judge Marquis makes it clear that she is very concerned about the fact that mental health assessment and evaluation was ordered by a mental health professional and Michael never completed it, right? So it was like super concerning to her because they're like, you know, we have all this erratic behavior. You haven't gotten treatment. What's going on? Okay. So Michael comes into court by himself without his previous attorney and is like, actually, I did get mental health assessment and treatment. And I go to this mental health counselor, Nancy Hutchinson. And so they're like, well, where's the documentation of that? So apparently he'd had a letter from Nancy Hutchinson that he had previously disclosed in his discovery packet. And he was like, Nancy Hutchinson. And, said, and he comes in with a new letter from Nancy Hutchinson. And that letter says, I do not believe that Mr. Mcdonald is a harm to himself or his children, and I believe that he's a fit parent. That's like the general broad scopes of what this line says in this letter. It's like a longer letter, but at the very bottom of it, it says that. And Judge Marquis is like, are you sure you want to introduce this letter? She's like, it looks a little weird, right? So like Michael is completely like unable to read the context clues here and say, oh, maybe I shouldn't do this, right? Because again, this letter came out of nowhere. There was no proof that Michael had been getting mental health treatment. And it had become clear that the court was really, really concerned about that. And it was really weird that Michael's attorney had just withdrawn from the case like the day before when he had been gung-ho all in with him, right? But he was like, no, I really did get mental health treatment. Can I please visit with my children now? And so the judge adjourns and basically contacts Ms. Hutchinson, goes and looks through the discovery packet, and finds out that this letter had previously been submitted, the same exact letter with the same exact date on it, but without that line at the bottom that Michael is not a harm to himself or his children, and I believe that he is a fit parent in my assessment, right? So it looked like, and it was a different typewritten font and everything. It looked like Michael had written that in himself or typed it in on a typewriter on top of or in like at the bottom of the doctor's actual real letter. So he basically forged the actual letter and presented it to the court as though it was real during the evidentiary hearing in order to convince the court that he should have visitation with his children. That's the way that it appeared anyway.
To this court and filed with this court on March 13th, 2018, your exhibit list. Included in that exhibit list, I'm looking at page number 7, that's your proposed exhibit number C, letter from counselor, dated August 31st, 2017. It's a letter to me, the Honorable Linda Marquis. It's interesting, I had some questions about that last sentence in that first paragraph. I was kind of concerned about it. Asked you about it a couple times. Counsel, I asked you about it a couple of times. Turns out, and you're not going to talk right now. Turns out on September 27, 2017, you filed a reply to an opposition and counter motion. And attached to that on page 18 was a letter from the counselor. That letter is dated August 31st, 2017. It's the same letter. Same letter to me. And guess what's not there? That sentence in the first paragraph that says, I do not believe Mr. Mcdonald is a harm to his children or himself. So I guess my concerns were right. You, my friend, were attempting to defraud this court with fake evidence. Now, no, you are not going to talk. I'm going to appoint counsel to represent you because now your Sixth Amendment does kick in. And you will face criminal. criminal contempt charges in front of me.
And at that point, the judge stalled the proceedings and basically was like, I am referring this to the state's attorney for criminal charges. I'm referring to the state's attorney for criminal charges because I believe that you have committed fraud. And not only fraud, also perjury, because he was under oath. And he said while he was under oath, oh no, this is completely fine. Dr. Hutchison did this. She gave this to us. Like, she gave this to me for me to give to you. And I don't know what you're talking about. It's totally fine, right? It's not a forgery. So he perjured himself when he lied to the court under oath. And also in the state of Nevada, she said, this is a burglary, which is very, very interesting. So you can commit a burglary in the state of Nevada by entering into a public building with the intent to commit a crime. In most places, a burglary is on a private person's property when you enter into it with the intent to commit a crime and do some type of manipulation of the entryway. But she was like, this is like felony burglary, felony perjury. And I'm referring to this to the prosecutor's office, right? The people of the state of Nevada. And so she does that. And part one is going to end right there. Okay, guys. So that is part one of the Michael Mcdonald saga. That is basically the entire overall scope of the underlying family case, the divorce case that ended with Michael Mcdonald and who became Candace Ruiz being divorced, him losing the house, having to pay her, and then losing total custody of his children. And now there are criminal charges. Let me know what you guys think in the comments section down below. Do you find this type of content and this form of video, which is more free form and long form, to be interesting? I want to know if you're interested in this type of content. Yes or no? Let me know. Be totally honest because I want to give you guys what you want to see. And I'll talk to you later. Bye. So Mr. Mcdonald also ran for the Nevada General Assembly for his local district on a platform of family law reform and criminal law reform, which he said was motivated by what happened to him during this case. That does later on become relevant in the actual criminal case. So it's just something for you guys to, think about. Here he is giving a speech at a political event.
So I also am running on the family and criminal law reform platform to reform our family court and our criminal courts. There's so many things that need to be changed. We have judicial oversights and there's barely any going on. There's a lot of nepotism in our courts and I'd like to help change that. Some of our DV laws, we have the number one for domestic violence, yet we also have such a big standard of what domestic violence is. We're trying, maybe we could go and if elected, I would like to enact legislation to do a high set instead of do a standard of what that is and to clearly define that and what you can go to jail and also not have the state pick it up or especially for non-meritous cases, so on a case-by-case basis. So I've got a lot of plans if elected and I look for your support. So thank you.
Thank you, Michael.